I can't believe I'm standing on the Avenue Q stage. This is so exciting. I'm Jennifer Ashley Tepper, and I'm a theater historian. Today I'm going to be talking about the intersection of real estate and art. As a theater historian, I've always been fascinated by the Broadway theaters themselves because they make history so tangible. I might not be able to go to opening night of Rodgers and Hammerstein's Oklahoma, but I can go to the exact theater where it played, sit exactly where they sat, and watch a new musical premiere in all of our time. Just being in that theater makes me part of something that's greater than myself. But how do you actually measure the importance of a Broadway theater? And what exactly defines a Broadway theater? A Broadway theater in 2016, most of you already know this, but has 500 or more seats, is located in a specific area of Manhattan, and follows rules set forth by the Broadway League and other organizations. So the McDonald's on 42nd Street might have 500 seats, might be in the theater district, but do you think it's a Broadway theater? We're off to such a good start. Thank you. But how do the Broadway theaters themselves come into play when it comes to Broadway's overall success? There are 40 Broadway theaters, soon to be 41, but we'll get to that. Where have the 100 longest-running musicals played? On this chart, you can see each theater's name is in direct proportion to how many long runners it's had. You can look at the same thing for plays. If you are a new play and you go to the Booth Theater, you're technically 11 times more likely to become a long-running play than if you go to the Belasco. We can look at the same thing for Tony Award winners. If you're a new musical and you go to the Richard Rodgers Theater, you're technically 8 times more likely to win the Tony Award. Not just this year, other years too. 8 times more likely to win the Tony than if you go to the Nederlander Theater. So clearly some theaters, it's all love up here. Clearly some theaters have an advantage over others. Some of the factors that might cause a theater to have an advantage, the location, the number of seats in the orchestra, which affects how strategically you can price your theater, the shape of the theater, and the current state of the theater. So obviously some theaters have an advantage, they end up getting the more desirable shows, which then wind up being more successful, kind of creating this cycle where we have these very popular Broadway theaters and these somewhat less coveted Broadway houses. Even when a show is a hit, the theater selected can really impact its success. Case in point, Phantom of the Opera. Producer Cameron McIntosh originally wanted Phantom of the Opera to go to the Martin Beck Theater, now the Al Hirschfeld. The show ended up at the Majestic, which is 455 seats larger. If we're stingy with our estimation about this, because we have to guess, and we guess that those seats were 75% sold throughout Phantom's run at $100, that's the difference of over $398 million more because Phantom went to one theater instead of another. So clearly the ways that all of these pieces of art occupy the real estate can really change how successful they are. Now with that in mind, does anyone know the name of a Broadway theater we've lost in the last 50 years? Marasco. The original Helen Hayes, that's true. Oh. my heart for the Helen Hayes. In the last 50 years, we've actually lost 16 Broadway theaters. We've gained 5 Broadway theaters. These are all Broadway theaters we've lost in the last 50 years. They were gotten rid of because they weren't seen as successful at the time. They didn't have as many tenants. The land could be used for something more valuable. This was largely in the 80s, which was a dark, unsuccessful time for Broadway and for New York overall. Now, the theaters in purple are theaters that have not been destroyed. They've just been repurposed. They could technically become Broadway theaters again someday. More on that later. 16 we lost, 5 we gained. These are all long-running plays and musicals that found huge success at theaters that we've gotten rid of and we no longer have anymore. Now, something that has not been studied much at all, the average size of the theater we've lost is about 900 seats. The average size of the theater we've gained is about 1,600 seats. So clearly we've gotten rid of a lot of our smaller and mid-sized theaters, and the Broadway theaters we've gained have been these huge houses. What do we think we've done to Broadway by changing the physical shape of it in this way? Have we made more room for certain kinds of shows, less room for others? In order to look at that, let's look at 4 recent hits. Fun Home, Gentleman's Guide, Avenue Q, and Once. Now, what do these 4 shows have in common? They were each actually the first production to win the Best Musical Tony Award at their respective theaters. So clearly the fates of some of these smaller theaters have started to change in this way and others. And if some of those other smaller theaters had stuck around, we might have a lot more art and money made. Next to each of these theaters that have had more recent success, a theater that's about the same size that we've gotten rid of. You might think, oh, we've gotten rid of our smaller theaters, we just won't have smaller shows now. But actually what has happened is that the art form leads the way. now that these shows are happening, they've just more and more started to get locked out of Broadway. I think that's the only time Etc. has ever been on a marquee, so I wanted to show it. To take this even a step farther, what actually could be if we had some of these theaters today? The Edison Theater on 47th Street was a Broadway theater that could be turned into an immersive, interactive space. It was even a Broadway theater in the round at times. It's currently the Edison Ballroom. A couple seasons ago, the Public Theater was looking for a home for its hit show Here Lies Love to transfer to. They couldn't find one, if you remember, that fit their spatial and aesthetic needs. This one would have. The Bijou on 45th Street was often home to smaller, more experimental plays and musicals. If we had the Bijou today, it would be a perfect home for something like Buyer and Seller to have a spot on Broadway that fit its financial needs. Even smaller, the Latin Quarter was the home of Pump Boys and Dinettes. It was a very special Broadway space for theatrical concerts. If we had the Latin Quarter today, it could be somewhere where an Encore's Tick, Tick, Boom or other concerts of a theatrical sort could transfer. The Mark Hellinger, now the Times Square Church, once home of classic Broadway musicals like My Fair Lady and Jesus Christ Superstar. If we had the Mark Hellinger today, we would have another place for all this surplus of product, because there's also, of course, all these big Broadway shows trying to come in, not enough spaces for them. The Mark Hellinger, beautiful palatial space, still in great shape, would have been a perfect spot. What did start to turn Broadway around, and how do we make it even better? It really took people with power starting to invest in the physical theaters and the real estate around them for Broadway to begin to flourish as an art form and as a business again. Here we can see the New Amsterdam Theater in its heyday, the Ziegfeld Follies, in disrepair in the 80s, and as today as home of Disney's Aladdin. Over the years, tons of producers and theater companies were offered this space. They all said it will never work, we'll never get families to come to Broadway, walk around all of that crime. It took the power of Disney with the city's help to really turn the space around, and the whole street and the whole area began changing as a result. Similarly, Rent came into the Nederlander. That theater had not had a hit in decades when Rent came in. We would not have that space today if Rent hadn't saved it. The Roundabout Theater Company took the Selwyn, which hadn't even been a Broadway theater at all for decades, and turned it into the American Airlines Theater that we know today. As recent as 15 years ago, the Biltmore was completely abandoned, and now it's Manhattan Theater Club's Friedman Space. All of these moves have made millions of dollars, have made hundreds of Broadway shows. So what do we do? How can we make the future better? Broadway is completely controlled by real estate. Who can get which theater and when has a huge impact on whether a show's a success or even happens at all. So in order for our art form to thrive, we really need to pay as much attention to the real estate as we do to the shows. The first thing we can do is invest in historic places and really think long term. Progress has brought us huge rewards in Times Square, but in making some of this progress, we've often destroyed very historic places that really could be a valuable part of our present and of our future. To build the Marriott Marquis, six Broadway theaters were destroyed. There were protests, some of you might remember, but these theaters met the wrecking ball anyway. There's Susan Sarandon getting taken into the police van after one of the protests. If we had these theaters today, they would be so filled with shows. Some people ask, would progress even be possible if all of these theaters were landmarked? But the truth is that yes, there are compromises to be made. In fact, in the 80s, the Save the Theaters Committee came up with a plan to integrate the existing theaters into the Marquee, but it was deemed unnecessary because we didn't need those theaters at the time and too costly. Now we can see this might have been a great choice. You don't want to make Joe Papp cry. The next thing we can do is to compromise. When all these theaters were demolished, many of the remaining theaters were landmarked. In order for that to happen, we had to start making more compromises, such as letting the owners sell air rights. With that in mind, another compromise. Should the Palace Theater be lifted up four stories to make room for retail space? It may be necessary to continue making compromises like this one in order to keep these 100-year-old theaters on this insanely valuable land. The next thing we can do is reclaim theaters and claim new ones. This is an amazingly exciting time to be around Broadway. Producers are battling for this limited number of houses like never before. There are all these shows with the money to get to Broadway and not enough spaces to hold them. It's an exciting time to be around these streets. Right now, the Schuberts are building a brand new Broadway theater on 45th Street. The Hudson, which hasn't been a Broadway theater since the 60s, will be a Broadway theater again by next season. And then there's all of these other spaces that are just waiting for the right show, person, idea to come in and turn that into a reality. if we dream about this a bit, there's Stage 42, formerly the Little Schubert, at a couple seats that could be a Broadway theater someday. There's the Times Square Theater right behind those pillars, completely abandoned, just waiting for the right owner to come in and bring it back to life. There's the Times Square Church and the Edison Ballroom, both former Broadway theaters we talked about, could be Broadway theaters again someday. And then there's spaces like Bond 45. They recently announced they're leaving their restaurant space and going elsewhere. Even something like that could be a Broadway theater with the right minds at work. Really, anything in Times Square could. Anything's possible. The last thing we can do is keep an eye on the past as we plan the future. Right now, the Colonial Theater in Boston, Broadway's most important out-of-town tryout theater, is in danger of being destroyed after 116 years of shows. When we get rid of theaters like that, we're not only destroying history we can really never get back, we're destroying history that has not even happened yet. If we do not learn from the past, we are doomed to repeat it. Boston theater, just like New York, as we've seen, will bounce back, but it's dependent on us keeping these physical spaces alive in order for it to do so. At the end of the day, productions are temporary, people are temporary. The one thing we can really keep from generation to generation is these places. They give our art form a continuity and a legacy that makes it unlike any other. As we've seen, the Broadway theaters have immense value, but in many ways, their value is also completely beyond measure. How we treat these theaters and the decisions we make about them affect the Broadway shows we get today and all of the Broadway shows that we'll get in the future. Thank you.